we thank you. Thank you, Jesus. We will never, I will never understand how you can love a sinner like me. But God, I am so thankful that you did go to the cross. Please touch us now. Be with us as we go continue to serve. May we honor you and always give you our best. Thank you. Jesus Christ, that we pray at home.
Guilty.
take your Bible this morning, and we're going to start in Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 to 11, and then we're going to move to Hebrews chapter 3. But let's start in Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. Matthew 4, beginning at verse 1. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. Did you get that? He was led by the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, into the desert for the purpose of being tempted. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And the tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Strange temptation. Tell stones to become bread. You'll always be tempted in your area of weakness, first and foremost. And Jesus was physically weak because he had not eaten a bite in 40 days or 40 nights. So now you understand the temptation. He's weak physically, and he's famished. So the devil, the tempter, tempts him in his area of weakness. He's going to tempt you in your area of weakness. I promise. Jesus answered, verse 4, "It is written, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Verse 5, "Then the devil took him to the holy city, and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. 'If you are the Son of God,' he said, 'throw yourself down. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone.'" The devil used the word of God against Jesus. Psalm 91. Can you quote Psalm 91? The devil did. Verse 7, Jesus answered, "It is also written, and I'll put the Lord your God to the test." Verse 8, again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give you," he said, "if you will bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." And then the devil left him. Other records of the gospel say this, "until an opportune time, and angels came and strengthened him." Now turn to Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4. Let's read. Verse 15. Well, let's start at verse 14. Hebrews 4, verse 14, and follow. "Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet was without sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." The Bible has much to say about the sinlessness of Jesus. We just read of two places in the Word of God where Jesus was tempted and sinned not. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21 says this, "God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that in him we might be made the very righteousness of God." Hebrews 7:26 says this, "He is holy, blameless, pure, set apart from sinners."
1 Peter 2:22, he committed no sin. Never a sinful word, never a sinful thought, never a sinful deed. Not one. 1 John 3:5, he appeared so that he might take away our sins, because in him there is no sin. Now, Jesus never sinned. Ever. Though he was tempted to sin. And the Bible says that he was tempted just as you and I are tempted to sin, but he sinned not. Now let me ask you this question, and don't answer it because I don't want you to embarrass yourself. Could Jesus have sinned? He was tempted. He was tempted just as you and I are. He didn't sin, but could he? That question has been the subject of theological debate for ages. The point that Jesus, in his humanity, could have sinned is called peccability, and the point that Jesus could not have sinned is called impeccability. And theologians on both sides of the debate agree Jesus never sinned, but they debate as to whether or not he could have he wanted to. It's a difficult thing for us to get our minds around Jesus being fully God and yet at the same time being fully man. 1 Timothy 3:16, Paul writing to the pastor, Timothy says this, "And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness, that God was manifest in the flesh." That's a great mystery. We can't get our minds around that. How Jesus could be fully God and at the same time fully man. Now let me ask you this. In his humanity, could he have sinned? We know he didn't. We've got the record of it, but could he have? Now I know where I'm at. I know where you all live. And I know what's down the road. This world headquarters of the Seventh-day Adventists, and there is a lady by the name of Ellen G. White, a mom of the Seventh-day Adventists. They consider her to be a prophetess. She wrote a book, The Desire of the Ages. In that book, she teaches that throughout Jesus' earthly life and ministry, he constantly struggled to avoid sinning. Is that true? No. It's not true. It's false teaching. But while Jesus didn't sin and didn't struggle all of his life to avoid sin, now here's the question, could he have? Fully man. Fully man. And fully God. Could the sinless Savior have sinned? When God became flesh, a human being, a human nature was joined to his already divine nature. The result was one person, Jesus of Nazareth, Jesus the Christ, who had two natures. One divine, one human. In his human nature, could he sin? The composite of two natures is called, big words, hypostatic union. It's where God the Son took on human nature, yet remained fully God at the same time. Let me ask you a question. Which nature was first? Which was he first? Was he divine first? Or human first? We all know that divine first. Let me ask you this. Did man become God? became man. And contrary to the false teaching of Kenneth Copeland and Benny Hinn, who on TBN years ago with Paul Crouch standing there, Kenneth Copeland and Benny Hinn, who became his disciple on this teaching, said that you and I will one day all be gods. Little gods. 1 John 3:2 says this, "Now, dear children, what we will be has not yet been made known, but we know this, when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Therefore, they argue that one day you will be like God." Let me tell you something about that. That's a lie. Because there are some attributes of God that are totally non-transferable. There are some ways that you'll be like Jesus one day. You'll never be omnipresent. That's one of the attributes of God. He's everywhere at the same time. You'll never be omnipotent. You'll never be omniscient. Now listen to me. We're going to be like Jesus, but we are not going to be little gods. There is someone who thought one day they would ascend to the Most High. And make yourself like the Most High God. His name was Lucifer. He got kicked out of heaven for that kind of nonsense. Now listen to me. Are you interested in this? See, I'm convinced this. The more that we know Jesus and the more that we know about Jesus, the more we're going to love Jesus. And Jesus said to the lawyer that tested him, "Rabbi, what is the greatest commandment in all the law?" And Jesus said, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment." So, if I can give you something every week that helps you to think about Jesus and know Jesus better and love Jesus more, then I feel like I've accomplished something. So today, here's the question. If Jesus is fully God and yet fully man, and he was tempted just as you and I are, could he, as a human being, could he have sinned had he chosen to? Well, he wasn't going to choose to.
Amen.
Now I want to give you several reasons, and I'll show you at the end why this is so incredibly important, and why our Savior is so magnificently gracious and merciful and wonderful in what he did for us. Number one, write this down. If Jesus could have sinned, there would have been no eternal plan of salvation. Let me prove it to you. Take your Bible and turn to Revelation chapter 13. Turn there. Revelation 13. And let's look at verse 3. Revelation chapter 1, John was commissioned to write what he'd seen. Chapter 1 of Revelation, he saw it glorified Christ. Then he was commissioned to write what is now. It's Revelation chapter 2 and 3, the age of the church. Write what will take place later. That's after the age of the church. And the church disappears from the pages of Scripture, beginning in Revelation chapter 4. Doesn't appear again until the wedding supper of the Lamb. So what you have here is a time of great tribulation, a time of Jacob's trouble. But look what is said in Revelation chapter 13 about the Lord Jesus Christ. It says, "All inhabitants of the earth will worship the beast, all whose names have not been written in the book of life belonging to the Lamb that was slain creation of the world. Now, look this way. Revelation 13, 8 tells us that Jesus is the Lamb of God that was slain from the foundation of the earth. Before there was ever, listen to me, a sinner, God had planned for a Savior. Watch this. The Bible teaches that Jesus Christ, before creation, would be the Lamb of God who would pay for our sin and provide salvation. God established that before creation. Now watch this. If Jesus could have sinned, Jesus couldn't have been the Lamb before creation, because God would have had to wait to see what he would do. If Jesus could have sinned, God's redemptive plan for Jesus to be our Savior, it would have hung in the balance until after the death of Jesus. Till after he had been tempted in every way, just as we are, God's plan of redemption would have hinged upon whether or not Jesus would have sinned. You get this? Folks, this ain't no shallow stuff. We want to teach you something, give you something with some meat on. All right, now watch this. For Jesus to be man's Savior, Jesus could not be a sinner. If he yielded to temptation and sin, guess what? He couldn't be the Savior. He would need a Savior. And if he could sin at temptation, God would have had to wait till after temptation to see if he would qualify as a sinner. But from eternity past, before there was ever anything but this, before there was ever one sin or one sinner, God, listen to me, plan for Jesus Christ to be the Savior. And God did not have to wait and see if Jesus would yield to temptation, because he wouldn't. Number two. Turn to James. Nor does he tempt anyone. Now look at verse 14. But each one is tempted when by his own evil desire he is dragged away in and enticed. Then, after desire has conceived, this, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, it gives birth to death. Where does sin come from? Where does your sin come from? Well, the devil made me do it. Paul. Now, while we told you already that one of the attributes of God is this, omnipresent, everywhere at the same time, is the devil omnipresent? No. Then how do you explain? Well, wait a minute, brother. My people in Thompsonville are doing some sin today. And people in West Frankfurt, and people in London, and people in Russia, and people in China, and people in Antarctica, and people in Australia. People all over the planet are sinning. And folks think, well, the devil made him do it. And the devil's really working on him. Are you arrogant enough that you think with all that the devil's got to do, he's really concerned about you, where you are? You know why there's sin going on all over this planet, all the time? Because each and every person on the planet is a sinner by at birth, because they are sinners by nature. And you will sin on your own without the devil being within 100 miles of you. The Bible says this, that you sin because you have a sin nature. Each one is tempted when by his own sin nature, his own evil desire, he's dragged away and enticed. You see that? So let me ask you the question. If sin or evil desire comes from our sin nature, and you'll do wrong on your own with nobody around and with no help, where does evil desire come from? The sin nature. Therefore, question needs to be asked. Did Jesus have a sin nature? No. Sin nature produces evil desire. Jesus didn't have one. Watch this. He did not sin. And he could not sin because he had no sin nature. Folks, if Jesus could have sinned, God's plan of salvation would have had to wait and see how he handled temptation. And Jesus, I can't understand this. How you can't even get your mind around him being fully God and fully man. Not having a sin nature. But a third reason why Jesus could not have sinned is this big word, kind of like impeccability, but it's immutability. And Jesus could not sin because of the immutability of God. Now, if I were to take you in your Bible to the last book of the Old Testament, the book of Malachi, and you ought to read the book of Malachi because it's so parallel to the times in which we live. And after the book of Malachi, God never said another word for 400 years. God said to the people through Malachi, he said, I wish you'd shut the temple doors. God said, I wish you wouldn't even have worship if you're going to have it when you've been had. Because you want the people were given God by way of sacrifice and put them out of God, crippled animals, blemished animals. Never given God the leftovers and the junk. He never got the best. Never. Kind of like the permit sale stuff. We can't sell it, so we get what's left over to roll from it. In the book of Malachi, it's a very famous verse. It's not just a tithing verse. In Malachi chapter 3, verse 6, God says, I do not change. In Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8, it says this, that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So God does not change and has not. Jesus does not change and did not. He cannot change for the better. He is the superlative of everything that is good. He cannot change for the worse, for he would cease to be who he is. And throughout eternity, all of eternity, God has been holy. In fact, when Isaiah got a vision of the throne of God, there are these angelic beings serving the throne of God, and with six wings, two they cover their eyes, and two they cover their feet, and with two they do fly, and they say this constantly, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, all the time, never ceasing, that God is holy, holy, holy. Because God is gracious, but it never said he's gracious, gracious, gracious. And we know he is. But the Bible describing God, listen to me, and these angels flying around the throne praising the name that is above every name, say this: he is holy, 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 always has been, and always will be. He's immutable. Now, for Jesus Christ to have been able to sin, he would have been able to cease to be holy. Watch. When he ceased to be holy, he would have changed from what he had always been up to that point. Now listen to me. Had he chosen to sin, he would have ceased to be holy and become a sinner. So then, that brings us to this question. Well, Brother Mike, if Jesus could not sin, why was he tempted to sin? And why was he tempted just as we are? Now listen to me. Temptation does not imply the possibility of sin, because James 1:13, God cannot be tempted by evil. Now, folks, if God cannot be tempted by evil, and Jesus was tempted but could not sin, why was he tempted? We often think of temptation, watch this, as the devil's idea. Remember how we started in Matthew chapter 4, verse 1? Was the temptation of Jesus the devil's idea or God's idea? It's God's idea. And he was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. Now listen to me. The temptations of Jesus were not to see if he would sin. They were to prove that he would not sin. They were not about his being defeated by the devil. They were all about him defeating the devil. Watch. Because Jesus would not sin and could not sin, he is the impeccable, sinless Son of God. Well, some might say, well, if Jesus was truly human, he had to be able to sin. No, he didn't. And I want to illustrate that to you. All right? Everybody says you can do it. Here, raise your right hand. Those are asleep. Now listen to me. As a Christian human being today, you have the promise of eternal life in heaven one day. Am I right? Right. That's the easiest question I'll ask you. Now let me ask you this. In heaven, will you still be a human being?
Angels followed him, and they got kicked out. So he was listening to me. They won't sin.
not be able to sin in heaven, even as Jesus was not able to sin on earth. You see, it's not the location of heaven that will keep you from sinning. Who's the first illustration for that? One third of the angels. Now demons are an illustration of that. But the guarantee of not being able to sin in heaven is this. You will be like him. Wow. Why is this important? A lot of things I've been preaching. I like it, son, brother. I don't need it as death. Categorize yourself. Why is it so important? Listen to me. Your eternal security depends upon it. If Jesus could have sinned on earth, then Jesus could sin in heaven. If he could sin in heaven, and you're going to be just like him, then you could sin. If you could sin in heaven, you could be cast out of heaven and banished. But that won't happen.
Amen.
You are eternally secure.
Amen.
In Jesus, listen to me, because of his impediment, he couldn't sin on earth. Cannot sin in heaven, you're going to be like him. And how secure will we be because of him? No wonder the old song says, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly, totally lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand. Now, turn your Bibles for the last time today to 2 Corinthians 5. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 21. If I was going to underline one verse in the Bible or no other, it might be this verse. If I can highlight one. My God. 2 Corinthians 5, 41. Now watch this. Remember, all the while thinking about your sinless Savior, what it says. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Do you understand this, that on the cross, all of your sin was charged to the sinless Son of God? And all of his righteousness has been credited to you. Now that don't make you love him and want to serve him and praise him and worship him. What else does? I say it all the time, that on the cross Jesus was treated as if he lived my life and sinned all my sins so that I could be treated before the Father as if I had lived his life and sin no sins. Wow. And that's what a Savior. What a Savior. Let's stand to our feet. Father in heaven, we thank you for the word of God. Once again, we speak to the ours to preach the lift up Jesus. We know we'll never do it justice. We never do it. Thank you. those among us would say that you, Lord Jesus, are our Savior. I pray that they'll love you, Lord, because of what we've seen in your word about you. And I pray, God, because of you, we'll be better Christians. We'll be better people. We'll be better church. And I pray, God, help us. Help us to be constantly reminded how magnificent the salvation you have provided for us is. Lord, today, if there's anyone here who's never experienced the forgiveness of sins in Jesus Christ, I pray today, by the power of your Holy Spirit, you convict them of sin and convince them the only way they can be right with you is through faith and trust in Jesus. What he did for them on the cross, when he paid for their sin in full, died in the place of the Lord. And Lord, today, by your grace, who is up there, would you give them the desire and the power to turn from sin and turn to Jesus. And may those of us who have leave here today a little bit revived, a little bit pumped up, a little bit excited, a little bit enthusiastic, a little bit happy. Happier than we were when we came in, because we've seen what an incredible salvation we have. In your Son, the only Savior. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Brother Danny, lead us in a soft invitation. If you never turn from sin and turn to Jesus, we invite you today to step out from where you're standing, make your way to the front, and acknowledge before these folks in this church today that today I turn from sin and I take Jesus to be my Savior. Today I have a new life, a new start in Jesus Christ. And I turn from life as I've been living and sin as I've been sinning to the only Savior who paid for it on the cross. Won't you come?